agua a muro. Para sa pagbabago. Sawa na ang bayan ko sa magnanakaw na tapo. Madilim na kahapon, ikaw ang mag-aahon. Sa piling mo, di ko mawawala ang korupsyon. Tayo na, Pilipinas, tayo na. Kamay tayo para sa pag-asenso.
May I request everybody to remain standing as we collectively pray our prayer for peace.
Let's put ourselves in the presence of the Almighty. Praise be to the Almighty, fountain of love and compassion, our source of peace. Cleanse our hearts of bitterness and grudge, so that we may forgive. Teach us, our Divine Master, to always seek what is good and just in others. Inspire us to be instruments of peace at all times and in all places. Guide each effort in our lives, so that our faults and transgressions may not keep us from the peace you promised. Grant us your strong spirit of peace, a peace that surpasses our understanding, but most of all, a peace that changes lives and breaks the walls created by our differences. Bless us with the strength of heart and courage of spirit to impart peace, so that there may be unity in times of crisis, amity beyond our diversity, and compassion in this world of indifference. Guide the leaders of our nation. Give them the knowledge and the wisdom they need to ensure that justice prevails throughout our land. Protect and guide our peacemakers, peace builders, and peacekeepers. Keep them safe and secure even as they go about their missions in the most violent of places. Give us hope in times of darkness and despair, so that we may never lose faith in your infinite goodness. Lead us into the way of peace, so that we may be instruments of your light and love, sowing love where there is hatred, spreading joy where there is sadness, forgiving those who have caused injustice, comforting those in pain, and healing victims traumatized by war, discrimination, and abuse. We pray in the hearts of all for the guidance of your pure and peaceable wisdom. All this we commit to you in your most holy name and in all your wonderful creations. Amen.
You may all be seated. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. Maayong hapon sa atong tanan. Bangsa Moro occupies Malacañang. As we make history again today with another milestone, as we witness the signing of the executive order creating the new Bangsamoro Transition Commission, or BTC. The new Bangsamoro Transition Commission, with an expanded membership of 21, with 11 members, including the chair coming from the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and 10 nominated by the government. The BTC will craft the Bangsamoro Enabling Law that will ensure a more inclusive peace process, accommodating more voices in the process of implementing the Bangsamoro Accords. To tell us more about it, may we call on Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, Secretary Jesus Duresa.
Thank you. Your Excellency, Mr. President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, Your Excellency Kagi Murad Ibrahim, the Chairman of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, the chairman of the MILF implementing panel, Mohir Iqbal, and the prettiest person in the presidential table, the chair of the government implementing panel dealing with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, Irene Inday Santiago, members of the cabinet headed by our executive secretary, Bingbong Mijaldea, members of the cabinet, members of Congress who are all here, members of the diplomatic corps who are all here, members of the MILF Central Committee and their other officers who are all here, members of media, friends, ladies and gentlemen. Today marks another milestone in yet another effort to address what the president had always referred to as to redress a historical injustice of the Bangsamoro. We are going today to witness the signing of the executive order that will reconstitute the Bangsamoro Transition Commission, whose principal function is to craft an enabling law that will be entrenched in order to address all of these issues and address the aspirations of the Bangsamoro. So today we are all here. This is a very significant occasion because it will signal a restart of what had slowed down because of the failure of our previous Congress to enact the enabling law. So today, we'd like to welcome all of you. We are looking at a more inclusive approach to our peace process, and we are going to work with all factions, all groups of the Bangsamoro as we work towards the completion of that new enabling law. There will be other peace tables that will be established here on that will hear also not only inputs from the BTC, but it will also hear inputs from all sectors who will be affected one way or the other. And so it is today that we welcome all of you, and let's call on the next part of the program as we proceed in this afternoon's event. Thank you very much and good afternoon to all.
Dagang salamat, Secretary Duresa. On the part of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, we are much honored to have with us here this afternoon Chair Alhaj Ibrahim Murad to give us his message.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Excellency, President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, Excellency Jess Duresa of the Office of the Presidential Peace Process, Executive Secretary Mideldia, other members members of the cabinet, we have Foreign Secretary Yasai and the rest. Congressmen, members of the Senate, senators, local governments, officers, my colleague in the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and other guests who are with us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Good afternoon to everyone. Once again, I come here today in this historic place in the name of peace and for peace. I stand before you not to assert my leadership for a movement that has fought the government for more than 40 years. I stand before you to represent and assert the legitimate interests and aspiration of my people, whose desire for peace and justice has long been denied. I come here today not to cash in, quote, the dividend of peace, unquote. I come here today to offer partnership for peace, so that together our people and we may reap progress and development. I stand before you not to create division as a result of our assertion for a distinct identity. I stand before you to offer mutual understanding, so that despite our differences, we may still live together and build together a better future. Today, indeed, is a special day, and I am elated to witness the triumph of our collective desire to continue to pursue the path of peace despite the many challenges, and so build on the cumulative gains of our peace process. This certainly will hasten the process that will lead us to the full implementation of the Comprehensive Agreement on the Bangsamoro and the other agreements. The signing of the executive order that will reconstitute the Bangsamoro Transition Commission brings to the fore the sincere desire of the new administration under the able and strong leadership of His Excellency President Rodrigo Roa Duterte to continue the path to peace, given this, that the MILF, since the MILF, you will find the MILF as a sincere and willing partner, inshallah. It is our hope that the signing of the executive order will pave the way for the immediate passage of the enabling law that will translate the provisions of the CAB into a law. The CAB is the embodiment of the legitimate aspiration of the Bangsamoro people to determine their future and govern themselves within a larger Philippine Republic. It is an important step to ascertain what the President has always been mentioning, the historical injustices committed against the Bangsamoro people. It is not just our right, but it is the right thing to do. The CAB and its translation into BBL is not the franchise of the MILF. The benefit of the law will redound to the benefit of everyone in our region and the country in general. It is a law that will it is a law that will translate the aspiration of everyone for lasting peace and development in our homeland. It is not owned by anyone. The law is not owned by anyone, but everyone owns it. It is a peace covenant forged in the historical injustices so that henceforth we may no longer seek to destroy each other and build our, but instead build our country together. It is a law that seeks to bequeath to our generation a country that they can be proud and a history that they recognize the heroism of people that continuously resisted colonization and imperialism. And so, today, my friends, I am here and merely to witness, not merely to witness the signing of the executive order, but I am here to witness the rebirth of a new hope that we may finally achieve the fulfillment of the promise of a peace agreement for our future generation. I pray that peace, progress, justice, and brotherhood will reign in our homeland. Thank you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you, Chair Murad, for your message. Women, or a half of the population, are really in the forefront in peacemaking and peace building here in the Philippines. And President Duterte takes women seriously, and proof of that is his appointment of Ms. Irene M. Santiago as chair of the government implementing panel. May I call on Ms. Irene Santiago to give her message.
Rodrigo Roa Duterte, President of the Philippines, son of Mindanao, friend, distinguished guests. Who was it who said that the quality of a peace agreement rests on the quality of its implementation? Today, President Duterte will sign the executive order constituting the Bangsamoro Transition Commission. 4 days ago, the founding chair of the MNLF, Professor Noor Misuari, offered his full support for the president's efforts to bring peace to Mindanao at last. Thus, we are now geared up for the implementation of the agreement signed with the MILF in 2014 and of that signed with the MNLF in 1996. But we know that the tables where these agreements were negotiated were small tables, although important ones. There is a larger table outside. These are the people's peace tables. These are the tables where people's voices can and will be heard and taken seriously. People's participation is key to help make peace, and more importantly, to make peace last. Mr. President, the implementation phase will address the four fundamental human needs that are at the root of the protracted nature of the Bangsamoro struggle. These fundamental human needs are for security, development, fair access to decision-making, and acceptance of identities. Our work on normalization, including decommissioning, socioeconomic development, and transitional justice and reconciliation, while focused on the communities and camps racked by destructive conflict, will also be directed at what is called positive peace for our country. For you see, the silencing of guns of war brings only negative peace. We have to do positive peace to make peace and to make peace last. There are 8 pillars of positive peace: a well-functioning government, low levels of corruption, acceptance of the rights of others, good relations with our neighbors, sound business environment, high levels of human capital, equitable distribution of resources, and free flow of information. Mr. President, you have mentioned all those pillars at one time or another during the campaign as well as now. Couldn't this be the overall framework of the Duterte administration so that we finally address what is called the strategic deficit? That is the deficit brought about by the lack of connection between what we do on the macro level and what happens on the micro level, on the ground, where people live their lives. As I pointed out to the newly elected officials of the ARMM, it is not the proliferation of guns that is at the root of violence. It is the lack of all the pillars of positive peace. Mr. President, in the Global Peace Index, the Philippines is currently 139th out of 163 states and territories. If we all work as a system, the MILF and the MNLF, all departments and agencies, women who are half the population, the youth who are the majority of our population, and all sectors, and the CPP, NDF, NPA, because that agreement is coming along well. If we all work together to construct the 8 pillars of positive peace, perhaps, Mr. President, the Philippines will be in the top 10 of the most peaceful countries in the world by 2022. Permit me to borrow the powerful words of the editorial of the Times of India on the occasion of that country's independence. I find these words apt to where we are in the Philippines today, and I quote, "History, they say, is a bad motorist. It rarely ever signals its intention when it's taking a turn. This is that rarely ever moment history is turning a page." The Philippines today seems like it is actually 2 countries. One Philippines is looking down at the bottom of the ravine and hesitating. The other Philippines is looking up at the sky and saying, "Mr. President, with your bold leadership, it's time to fly." Thank you.
Thank you, Mami Dai. To also deliver his remarks, representing the MILF Peace Implementing Panel, let's welcome Chair Mohager Iqbal.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. His Excellency President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, Chairman and Brother Alhaj Murad Ibrahim, Honorable Secretary Jess Doreza, my partner in government, Madam Irene Santiago, members of the cabinet, members of Congress, members of the MILF Central Committee who are with us this afternoon, our brothers from the MNLF, other distinguished guests, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and good afternoon. On December 17, we would be marking the fourth year since the first executive order was signed, creating the Bangsamoro Transition Commission, or BTC. Optimism, especially among us Moros, was so high because of the then freshly signed Framework Agreement on Bangsamoro, or FAB, on October 15, 2012, and the issuance of what would be officially cited as Executive Order 120, which was later amended by Executive Order 187 on 2015. We thought and anxiously anticipated that before the 16th Congress would adjourn, the proposed Bangsamoro Basic Law, or BBL, would become a law. But as everyone here knows, the bill did not even make it to the second reading in both the Senate and the House of Representatives. Today, that optimism has been rekindled with the signing of the much-awaited executive order that would reconstitute the Bangsamoro Transition Commission. This new executive order would give a renewed hope for the early passage of the Bangsamoro Basic Law. When that happens, inshallah, we would be witnessing to the resolution of the more than four decades of conflict in Mindanao during the term of His Excellency President Rodrigo Duterte, a fellow Mindanaon with Moro ancestry. With this executive order, the task of enhancing the BBL is expected to officially commence sooner than we can anticipate. As the membership of the reconstituted Bangsamoro Transition Commission has been expanded, we expect the representation of various sectors of the Bangsamoro society so that the process of enhancing the BBL would be more inclusive and embracing, just as it was in the previous BTC that I had the privilege to lead. As chair of the MILF Peace Implementing Panel, I therefore call on all Moro groups to work together to come up with a BBL that will establish a real and genuine autonomy for the Bangsamoro people, which is faithful to the March 27, 2014 Comprehensive Agreement on the Bangsamoro, or CAB, and enhanced and improved by other agreements or any Solomonic ideas and wisdom. On this another historic stage in our common struggle to pursue the Bangsamoro right to self-determination, let us set aside our selfish, parochial, tribal, and or organizational interest and make the paramount the collective interest of the Bangsamoro who just demand the restoration of their identity, correction of the historical injustice committed against, and the resolution of their legitimate grievances. I also sincerely appeal to the Filipino people at large for their support in the establishment of lasting peace in Mindanao. Just give the Bangsamoro the chance to truly govern themselves in the genuine autonomous manner set up in the signed agreement, and we would work very hard for peace and development because that is what every one of us wants to achieve. I would like to state in advance my appeal to the current Philippine Congress, to our honorable senators and congressmen, to fast track the legislative process in passing the BBL. As I have consistently stated, and I reiterate, that we in the MILF trust the collective wisdom of Congress in passing the BBL. We still hold the trust. Please do not fail us, the Bangsamoro, and those who wish to have genuine peace among us, especially in Mindanao. At this juncture, I must say to everyone and sundry that the passage of the BBL is a national interest of this country. It would put to rest this longest running conflict in the world today. Lastly, we thank President Duterte for his efforts in moving forward the peace process. We have no doubt that the President really wants to end the conflict in Mindanao. Rest assured that the MILF would always remain committed to the peace process and the signed agreement engendered by it. Thank you very much and good afternoon.
Thank you, Chair Iqbal. And thank you for the entire Moro Islamic Liberation Front for keeping the faith in the peace process. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now proceed to the signing of the executive order by the President. May we request Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, Secretary Jesus Deresa, MILF Chair Alhaj Ibrahim Murad, Government Implementing Panel Chair Irene Santiago, MILF Implementing Panel Chair Mohager Iqbal, House Speaker Pantaleon Alvarez, and Senate President Aquilino Coco Pimentel to stand as witnesses. Thank you, Mr. President. And now that the executive order has finally been signed, may we call on Secretary Jesus Deresa to formally introduce the President.
Ladies and gentlemen, His Excellency, the President of the Republic of the Philippines, Rodrigo Roa Duterte.
Thank you. Let me sit down. Executive Secretary Mijaldia, Secretary Deresa, and the members of the Cabinet, Chairman Irene Santiago, and the GPH Implementing Panel members, Chairman Alhaj Murad Ibrahim, and our brothers from MILF, Chairman Iqbal, and the MILF Implementing Panel members, Chairman Muslimin Sema and the eminent Central Committee members, my fellow workers in government, my countrymen. I am a creature of Mindanao. Though when I ask from where I come, I would always say that I am a Cebuano because we trace our lineage from our paternal others, but actually I have not resided in Cebu, not even for the day. And so I've always considered myself from Mindanao, who was grown up in the place and saw everything that unfolded all these years. And one of those things really is the continuous strife, the internecine between our brothers, the Moro and the Christians ever since. I ran for president, and obviously this will be the first time that you would realize it, that while they were campaigning all along, I never really, in the sense that I did not directly involve myself with the campaign, and because I said I was not running. Problem is, as the campaign developed, I was appalled by the fact that nobody was talking about Mindanao. every one of them, the usual infrastructure project and blah, 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 blah. But never one of them, not one of them, ever said that we would take a second look to what will happen in Mindanao. And being there was an eyewitness to the so many body bags being carried out of Davao and those in the places where they were fighting for their lands. And I said that this would be a tragedy. Because if from here, if there's nobody who take the cudgels for Mindanao, then the fighting will continue. And I said, if there is no person who would stand for peace in Mindanao, then we'll have another round of 40, almost 45 years of fighting. So we were faced with the dilemma of fighting for another 45 years, added, or let alone to the problem of the Communist Party of the Philippines, with whom we were fighting for almost 45 years now. There seems to be no respite to the troubles that ailed the country. And so I decided to run on the platform that there will be a structure that must be acceptable to the people of the Republic of the Philippines. And one that must be adapted willingly by the Moro people of Mindanao. Ang problema dito, ako lang ang nasasabi noon. At sinasabi ko na uli, pabalik-balik yon, here and now again, I will tell you that without an altogether new framework and the best structure that would be acceptable to all would be a federal setup. And I said that if you can perfect the federal government apparatus by about the third, fourth year, and there would be a precedent, a strong precedent provided for that kind of government, I will willingly give up the rest of my term. I will resign and I give you my word now. Kung madalian lang sana to at kung mapadali natin, there will be no problem sa akin because it provides for a strong precedent. And since I'm elected for 4 years, but if you can just finish it in 3 to 4 years, I am out. That I commit to you. So madalian lang natin to. We can have a special autonomous within the federal government for the Muslim in Mindanao. But the historical injustice, I said, that's what I term the situation now, must be corrected. And it dates back to the time of Magellan. Well, he was comfortable capturing the islands of the Visayas and Luzon, but in Mindanao, they tried to do it, but they were not able to complete the process because Mindanao at that time was already 100% Islam. Doon ang nakaproblema. And because they were not only trying to inject a new system of colonial rule, but also a religion. That complicated matters, and that led into a bloody war for 400 years of resistance
by the Moro people, and when the Americans, by the terms of the Treaty of Paris, the Philippines was included as one of those conceded territories by the Americans. How it came about that Mindanao was included, that is really a mystery to all of us. But that started another round of trouble. And I said, pardon me for saying it, it's not really intended to just, and there's so many atrocities that accompanied the campaign. So that when I showed to everybody the photographs of those taken during the time and showed the pile of bodies of men, women, and children in a pit, in several pits in Mindanao, I would usually be answered by saying, Mayor, matagal na yan. That's 100 years. And I told them, that, you know, this picture is a portrayal of the problem until now. It is not 100 years old. It is today. Unless you're able to do something about this photograph, this photo. And mind you, it was not taken by the Filipinos at the time because nobody had that gadget called camera. Sa kanila yon eh. The only problem is they took pictures of it and piled it in the archives of their country. And so some enterprising Filipino got a copy of it. And so that's how we have these pictures of almost the brutality and cruelty of men. And mind you, the irony of it all, that it is the very country that's really trying to come up with this very late realization of what the human right is. Yan ang ano ko. So that when this came to Iroquois, I said that you should be the last to say those words. And for as long as we do not have a mechanism to ensure that justice has been served, we will never find peace in Mindanao. In the same manner with the communists, we must be able to address them. Otherwise, no president ever after me will be able also to solve it on time. Maybe over time. But I said what is very important is to educate the people. And that is why I am very much interested in the education of the Moro people. And you know, mind you, when I entered the mayorship, there was only one madrasa school. And today it has expanded to almost 169 because I wanted the Moro people educated so that they would know what to do with their country in the coming years. So my only desire is that peace in Mindanao would finally come. And if it can be done peacefully, without a fight, we would be grateful to God that not a single drop of blood has been shed in this a new undertaking of giving a country finally the deliverance from violence. Ako, hindi ko nga malaman, I you know very well, kayong mga half of my line of grandchildren are Muslims and half are Christians. So I would be the last person really to deny na hindi natin kailangan. Because I would still also be in a quandary if it indeed it happens and say, where is my loyalty? Saan ako niyan yung ilagay? And so if there's any one person, actually, who was really very much interested about peace at the start and even the campaign, it was my battle cry. Mindanao, and of course, corruption and the drug and the issues of criminality. But whenever I went around to, I always said that we have to have peace in Mindanao. And I was the only one talking about it, because the rest of the guys, with due respect, never knew any single issue about Mindanao. Either they did not know about it or just pretended not to talk about it. Fear to alienate the others, or not also frank enough to admit that there is a problem which we have to solve. And I hope it will be solved. From the time that I have signed that document, I will see to it. I will talk to the Speaker and to the Senate President and leaders to fast track it, because I want it. Baski yan na lang. If I could get a peace agreement with the communists and I'm hammer out something for the MNMI and to all the Moro groupings and even the Abu Sayyaf, if I could just extend my hand to them in friendship and just tell them that it is time to just really have a country which is normal and peaceful, and for our children to grow in peace, then I would have succeeded. Well, if I could just have this thing about territory, I'm ready. If you want to call an action as early as 3 years from now, I said I am willingly going to step down. And I hope to complete the process of destroying the apparatus. The drug problem in the country is not run by one person. As a matter of fact, the exchange stocks. Wherever there is a dirt of one supply, then they send another. So the exchange goods. And this is really an apparatus which the government must destroy, else it will be the reason for the failed state of the Philippine Republic. If you see now, lamo, totoo lang magprangkahan tayo. We are already in the narco-politics stage. Just like in South America, started as just a small time, and you should know the history. There are a lot of books written about how America failed its people. And in the border along Mexico and Arizona, Texas, and countries bordering it, there are now about 60,000 people who have died there. And nobody's complaining. Here, I have a problem of drugs, which is really there, supplied by many, either from out, thrown overboard, jettisoned, and somebody picking it up in the high seas or manufactured here. I would not like to dwell on the 1 million under my term, which started just a few months ago. I will limit myself to the already confirmed figure given by General Santiago of PDEA, was heading that agency. Ang lumabas ganito, there are about 3 million at that time. I do not know where to add the 1 million that's coming my way to solve or to just leave it there as a separate figure, because kukwentahin lang ho ninyo sa 200 per hit, that is the prevalent price dito sa, I think all over the Philippines, it's 200. If you times that by 3 million, yung kay Santiago lang muna, you will have about 6,000 per month, per person. And if you multiply it by weeks, then you will have 18 billion a week, 18 billion a month, rather. And if you count it by years, that would be 216 billion a year. Money that is intended for food, money intended for the school of the children, money intended for medicine. A breadwinner in the family would lose that much. And not all of it are really honestly earned, for some of them were stolen from the other hands of those who are robbed, killed along the way. So the highest of crime. Kailangan talaga maputol ito, not only the individuals, but the apparatus itself. And mind you, again, I did not order the police to take punitive actions. I directed the police and the armed forces to go after them because I have declared war. And whatever the human rights guys would tell us, whatever be the characterization of the situation, I am declaring a war. And until the last pusher or the last drug lord is killed, this campaign will continue until the very last day of my term, however short or however long it is. I am committed to that duty. I am, do not pay, maybe pulling a chair here and say that I am the only one who can do it. But in my time, because I'm here, I will do it. And I do not care. You know, I would like to announce now that the 26,000 of M16 that was maybe ordered or were ordered already, I am ordering its cancellation sa police. And we will just have to look for another source that is cheaper and maybe as durable and as good as those made from the place we are ordering them. We will not insist on buying expensive arms from, we can always get them somewhere else. So, kalimutan na nila, sabi, it would be arriving on July of 2017. I am ordering the police to cancel it. Di natin kailangan, ano. And you know why? Ayun niya, bakit? Why should we hurry it? Yung baril na yan, bilihin ko? Sinong patayin ko niyan? Wala man tayong kalaban, tayo-tayo lang papatayan dito. So what's my hurry? I don't have to hurry. I buy bullets, what for? For the Filipinos. Eh, tatayo tayo lang dito. I will just cancel it. Contribute it to the success of the re-invigorated Bangsamoro Transition Committee. Huwag na mo tayo itang bilhin ng baril. let us just have a moratorium of violence and maybe we can use the money useful for some other endeavors. Yan lang hinihingi ko sa inyo. Kasi magbili ako, gagamitin lang rin yan para magpatayan tayo dito. So, what do we get? Because if we buy that, we have to buy bullets. And if you have the bullets, then, para patayin mo lang kapwa mo Pilipino. Or kapwa mo Moro. O kapwa mo Christian. So ako, I am committed to the peace process. I pray to Allah that it will succeed in my term. Sabi ko nga, baski yan na lang ang magawa ko para sa bayan, okay na ako. Then I can retire in peace. Maraming salamat po.
Daghang salamat, President Duterte. May we request the President to remain on stage for the photo opportunity per group? Our first batch will join Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, Jesus Doresa, and MILF Chair Alhaj Ibrahim Murad. The members of the government and MILF implementing panels, please come up on stage for a photo opportunity with the President. We request the members of the both panels to remain on stage, and we ask the members of the cabinet to join them on stage. Please, members of the cabinet. So we'd like to thank the members of the cabinet. At this point, may we call on the members of the House of Representatives to join our president and the both members of the panel of the GPH and MILF. And the third party monitoring team. May we also call the members of the third party monitoring team to join our members of the House of Representatives. Thank you to our members of the House of Representatives and our third-party monitoring team. At this point, may we call on members of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front to join our president and our panels. Thank you to our members of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. At this point, may we call on members of the Moro National Liberation Front to join the president on stage and both panels. Thank you to the MNLF, and may we request now other guests and civil society organizations and from the security sector to join our president and the panel for a photo opportunity. Thank you. We have finally reached the end of our ceremony. Thank you for joining us. Mabuhay ang Bangsa Moro, mabuhay ang Pilipinas. We would like to invite our guests to partake of the refreshments prepared to us by the Malacañang Palace on both sides of the Rizal Hall.